Good afternoon to everyone. So it's my pleasure to introduce Professor J.B. Joshi for the second time here on the same podium. He came here previously for our distinguished lecture series every year, annual distinguished lecture series. So Professor J.B. Joshi has completed his B.Chemie and M.Chemie from UDCT and his PhD from Padma Vibhushan Professor M.M. Sharma for us. And Professor Joshi has been a faculty of chemical engineering at UDCT, now ICT Mumbai, since 1972 until his retirement in 2009. During the last 10 years, he was the director of this institute. He brought autonomous and deemed university status to this institute. He also brought external revenue generation of 80% of the total expenditure, with only 20% from the state government. And this was perhaps a global record for any state-funded university. He has guided over 100 PhD students, 60 masters, and 30 postdoctoral students. He has published over 550 research papers in international journals of repute, and 25 in national journals. And these have over 20,000 citations and with an H index of 62. Professor Joshi is a fellow of the Third World Academy of Sciences and a fellow of all the science and engineering academies in India. He received the S.S. Bhatnagar Award in 1991 and was conferred the Padma Bhushan in 2014. As a president of Marathi Vidyan Parishad, actively driving the task of improving the scientific temper of the society through 10 different activities on which he is going to deliver the talk today. He is currently Emeritus Professor, Homi Baba National Institute, Mumbai. So, welcome you, sir.
Distinguished invitees and my dear friends. First of all, my sincere thanks to UPES and Professor Santosh Gupta and the group. I have participated in four activities up till now organized by him, and he is so meticulous in organizing. I am requesting him today to make one module of 5 lectures and give it to a variety of institutions, how to organize a program and make it successful. Thank you. Thank you so much. I have, I'm associated with 3 institutions. The first one is Marathi Vidyan Parishad, which basically does this job of improving scientific temper of the society. Of course, I'm with ICT, as well as Homi Bhabha National Institute. Next slide. So the objectives of Marathi Vidyan Parishad to disseminate scientific knowledge mainly through Marathi language, to enrich the Marathi language for the expression of scientific thoughts, to enhance the importance of science in life, and to contribute to research in science and technology for the cause of society. Here are some of the awards earned by Marathi Vidyan Parishad. Very recently, the Indira Gandhi Prize for Popularization of Science of INSA was given to our secretary, Mr. A.P. Deshpande, who has been secretary for 42 years. Next slide. These are some of the programs. We have daily column in local newspaper called Lok Satta. Every day this comes. Last year it was periodic table, and every day there would be an article on two elements, And since there are 123, we gave 123 lectures across the Maharashtra. Lectures on science popularization on Akashwani, All India Radio, and in the next month I will be giving 4 lectures on All India Radio. The Vishwakosh project, that is encyclopedia, the books and booklets on improving scientific temper, these are printed, these are e-books, the audio books and braille books. Now the special book on science and technological contribution of Maharashtra on the occasion of Diamond Jubilee, which is coming up in May 2020, this book is being written. Next slide. These are many more programs. Vijnana Anubhuti workshops, these are basically for school-going children. Math learning program, career counseling sessions, children science conferences. I think I request all of you to participate in this. You will be very, very happy to see the scene. A child of 9th standard, he gives a PowerPoint presentation, and audience also of 8th, 9th standard, they also ask questions, and it's a beautiful scene. Science and us for this year, that is December 2020, to arrange such a program across the country. So we will be inviting about 300 teachers. There will be screening, of course. Whenever such invitation is made, we get 3,000. Then we have to further screen. But this is a good program. Workshops on popular science writing. Next slide. Joy with Science, these are school-going children. This Saturday is for science. Here, all of you may remember that in your own school days, you did not perform experiments yourself. Some teachers in some schools, they demonstrate some experiments. So here, we go to the school. Now it is ongoing in about 330 schools. What we do is, science college students, that is first year, second year BSc, we teach them how to get these experiments done from the school. And this year, about 15,000, the program is coming to the end. It ends on 28th of February, that is Science Day. So this year, these many students will be performing experiments. This is science for differently abled students. Next slide. Many other programs, science experiment workshops, science through toys, science hobby workshops, science tours, science fairs, workshops on innovative ways of developing apparatus for science experiments, workshop on developing of concepts, workshops on inculcating innovative ability, workshops on research as a profession. This, we held about 300 workshops about 10 years ago that we did consecutively for 4 years, and the number of interested PhD students, we used to get normally 300 applications. And after these workshops, we started getting 2,000 applications. Not only ICT, many other institutions got many, many applications. Counseling for adolescent girls and boys, this is the most popular program of Marathi Vidyan Parishad. 3 lakh workshops have happened up till now, and it is continuing. Thousands of such workshops happen. Next slide. Then there is a Vijnan Ganga lecture series, one per month. This happens in the center of the city. Golden Jubilee year monthly lecture, this happens in the Marathi Vijnan Parishad. City farming workshops. Now the government of Maharashtra has declared that those societies which generate more than 100 kgs of wet waste, they should consume inside. So we have developed the technology for that, and this generates money for that particular society. And we have several success stories. And then there are special lectures. Next slide. We have awards and competitions conducted. One is Professor M.M. Sharma Award. We know on the national level, the most coveted award is Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar. So in order to inculcate the research activity in colleges and universities, we give this award. And why Professor M.M. Sharma? Because his entire research, he never wrote any research project. He never got any grant. So any college which can complain that we don't have money, we don't have laboratory, we don't have library, we don't have internet. Here is an example. Without all that, based on only innovative ideas, he has been able to go up to FRS. So we put that example before the college going college teachers as well as university teachers. This is happening for 6 years now, and we have started getting very good nominations, more than 25 from colleges and similarly from earlier there were 2 or 3. Maybe many more nominations have started coming because many more colleges are knowing about this program. But Marathi Vidyan Parishad can take the credit of this award that some of the college teachers have definitely started. And they are taking patents, they are publishing in international journals, they are developing some technologies for the society. So this is a very, very useful program. For research in science, there are awards. For research in engineering, there is Vishweshwaraya Engineering Award. We started recently, and the first award has gone to civil engineer who has built 200 kilometer road, and over a period of 10 years, there have been no potholes. So we will try to propagate his technology. Science fiction writing, science essay writing, at least we must have trained 50 writers who continuously keep on writing, and one of them is Professor Jayant Narelkar himself. He started writing because of this program. Next slide. I have written these objectives all over again, and now onwards I will be focusing on to contribute to research in science and technology for the cause of society. I'm very happy that Professor Vijay, he gave nice, very nice introduction, and my further lecture will be in continuation of that introduction. Next slide. What was done was, I visited 3 districts of Maharashtra where per capita income is very low. Per capita income of our nation is known to us is about 1 lakh rupees per year per person. And in these 3 districts, it is about 40,000. In the north, it is Nandurbar. Then in the south, it is Sindhudurga. And in the east, it is Gadchiroli. The Gadchiroli is the district which is dominated by Maoists and Naxalwadis. But we were told that if you are going there for understanding their problems and for the betterment of for their own betterment, then they will not trouble. But for other 2 districts, I took my students. Very recently, about 25 PhD students, 2-3 research guides, and we visited Nandurbar district with the help of the North Maharashtra University. So their PhD students, about 100 number, their guides, which were about 10, and we visited at least 20 places, and then we collect either housewives or the farmers and try to understand their problems. We also did 3 big symposia when Dr. Kakodkar turned 75. Then in 3 different places, we invited about 500 farmers, 300 PhD students, their guides, about 50, and the small-scale industrialists, the village people, and plenty problems were indicated by village people. I have a big library of the problems, and some of them have been solved. What I'm going to tell you in the next 30 minutes is what were some of those problems and how these were solved and how the implementation of solution is happening now onwards. So these workshops are very, very important. Normally, whenever we develop technology, some of the professors complain that we have done excellent work, but no industry is forthcoming to take our technology. But the actual real story I must tell you, I'm working with industry close to 50 years. If you understand their problem by going there and actually pinpoint what exactly is the problem and try to find the solution which increases the profit of that company, then I don't think any industry will deny. If we do research without understanding the problem, then there will be a problem. So here, with the help of workshops, we were able to identify problems. The first, in all these workshops, when we were asking, now these are many, many places, at least 40 places. And in 40 places, what was the number one problem? That the fertility of land is decreasing year by year. If I get, say, 12 quintals per hectare per year of soybean, then next year it is less, and then the next year it is less, and it is continuously decreasing, and many other problems. So what we thought, that we will address this problem first. And we selected 2 crops, that is soybean and sweet sorghum. Now if you see the global trade of soybean, soybean is grown by the American continent and imported by Asian continent. India is the largest importer of soybean. And in 2017, India imported soybean oil worth 18,000 crores. So, whether we can address this problem, we took collaboration of Agarkar Institute of Pune, the DST Institute, as well as Agricultural College in Kokand Krishi Vidyapit. Next slide. Here you can see that in 1961, what was the productivity in different nations? Egypt, Spain, United States, Brazil, Argentina, China, and India. In 1961, per hectare, we were growing about 0.5 tons. And after 50 to 60 years, we are growing now 0.6 tons. That much development has occurred. Whereas I will not read for many other, but China has gone up to 1.5, more than 1.5, and Egypt has gone up to 3. And why this happens? Next slide. Precision farming, point number one. Under that, the weather data, test-based nutrient and water management, preventive pest management, choice of crop based on soil, site suitability, adoption of sustainable crop production practices, then developing newer crop varieties, social interventions, the financial. Now out of all these points, we thought we will take one at a time, not all at a time, and that is related to soil. The soil analysis is known. The nutrients and micronutrients are about 21. The physical characteristics are 3 and macrobiological characteristics are 16. So depending upon the crops, if for example soybean, if we analyze the soil, then we come to know how far it is from the best soil. So from this difference, from 21 micronutrients and macrobiological, then with the help of char, because the principal problem has been the organic carbon. For fertile land, it needs to be about 2% in the soil, and average of India is 0.2. The result is very clear. The productivity of any crop in India is at least 1/3 than the globally, which is proven. So organic carbon has to be improved, in addition to many other micronutrients, and there are many more interventions are required. But what we thought as a, at first instance, to improve the quality of soil with the help of char, and that is biochar. And char has several properties. Next slide. Biochar is a biomass pyrolysis product. About this I will talk in more greater detail in about 2-3 minutes. It has high porosity, surface area, ion exchange capacity, bioavailable carbon, nutrients, and water holding capacity. And because of all these properties, the fertility of land, it improves. Next slide. Now these experiments were performed like for validation. Whenever we start new research activity, for validation of experiment, we try to do 2 times, 3 times, 4 times, and as the experience develops, then we may do it 2 times or later on only once. Now here, without any element of doubt or without any experience, for any combination of soil, given a soil together with char or together with say any inorganic fertilizer, 36 simultaneous experiments need to be performed all the time. 36 experiments. So if I am having say 10 combinations, then for those 10 combinations, say biochar 1 ton per hectare, 3 tons per hectare, 5 tons per hectare, or the biochar with inorganic fertilizer or organic fertilizer, I can have 20, 30 combinations, but for each combination, 36 experiments. Next slide. So here is, this is about 200 square feet, and 200 square feet, 36 plots for one. So how the arrangement is made with the farmers, we ask the farmer, what is your best productivity up till now? So say, for example, somebody has answered 12 quintals per hectare per year. So we promise them, you will get money at the end of the year equivalent to 12 quintals per hectare. Because of our experimentation, if you get more, then that is yours. Because of our experimentation, if you get less, then you will be paid the balance amount. And this way we have been able to make the participation of the farming community, and it is very useful because their participation is important, because labor is required, water management is required, which they know. And this way, over the 5 years, lot of experimentation has been done on soybean and some on sweet sorghum. Next slide. I will not go into the details, but for the case of soil carbon, there has been improvement in productivity by 85%. So the improvement has been between 25% to 85%, and intervention has been only on the soil, nothing else. And the when very, very few experiments have been performed by taking into consideration many other factors, and what Egypt has been able to do, that is 3 tons per hectare per year, we have been able to also achieve 3 tons per. So whatever is the current productivity increase has been by 600%, 85%, 25%, right? And we know scientific reasons why this has happened, and papers have been published in international journals. Of course, some of the authors are from the agricultural university. Next slide. This is sweet sorghum. In Maharashtra, lot of land is allocated for sugarcane, and lot of water is required. And then there is a water stress for drinking water, for animals, for industries, for forest. Whereas sweet sorghum, I'm going to show you the comparison, and these are the actual numbers. The sweet sorghum needs 1/6 water, and the plant which is required for producing sugar, the capital cost is 1/3 as compared to sugar cane. So with that as a starting point, now here is the comparison of sugar cane versus sweet sorghum. Basis is 3 years, and in 3 years we get 2 crops of sugar cane. First 18 months 200 tons, second crop 150 tons, the total is 350 tons. Average price in Maharashtra is about 2,500 rupees per ton, and total income is 8,75,000. The expenditure of water, labor and fertilizers put together is 2,50,000, and income of 3 years is 5,25,000, and income per year is 1,75,000 per hectare per year. Now let us remember this number, 1,75,000, and it is considered as a good cash crop in Maharashtra. Now let us see soybean. Next slide. Soybean grows in 4 months. So we get sorghum also, that is jawar. The stock that we have, that has about 75% juice, and that can be concentrated, and we get biomass. I have taken for the sugar the price which is 75% of the regular sugar price, and the jawar is of course 25 rupees a kilogram. This is the market, this is the price at which the farmers sell. And the biomass that we get, I'm going to tell you the utilization of biomass in greater detail after some time, but it is sold at say 2 rupees a kilogram. And the sorghum, which is for 4 months, we get 90,000 rupees. 1,75,000 rupees for sugar cane, that is per year. Now in 4 months we got 90,000. There can be a second crop, for example maize, and we have maize as well as biomass, you get another 110,000 rupees. So as compared to sugar cane, it is 200,000. Now another 4 months have remained. If the third crop is taken, which we have made it successful, you can get another 100,000. So as compared to sugar cane, now we are expected to get 3 lakh rupees per hectare per year. Now we need to convince the farmers to undertake this activity. So one of my PhD students, who is son of a farmer, he thought this is a good idea, and he started making a cooperative of 50 farmers. And this year we are going to use about 100 acres. they have promised to participate about 100 acres, and we will do it over a period of 3 years. And I'm sure from within that when all these numbers which are there, they result into a success story, then many more farmers, this will be in Solapur district, on the border of Solapur and Satara district, but many more farmers in Satara district as well as Solapur district, when there will be 5 success stories, then it will go further. Next slide. Now the biochar which was used, sweet sorghum, by the way, we have not done many experiments up till now for increasing the productivity. And if it is increased by 50%, whatever is done by, and our preliminary experiments have shown the same rise. When we say 25% to 85% rise, when the land is already fertile, we can make more fertile by only 25%. Right? When it is unfertile, then we can increase the fertility by 85% or even 200%. But the land, whatever it is there, and we have to start from that point onwards. So the principal component that we are using for improving the productivity is biochar. And biochar is obtained from biomass. Next slide. This is the statistics of the available crop residues in India, right from rice, wheat and sorghum, maize, all put together, the crop residue is 600 million tons, out of which available is 300 million tons, and the nutrients which are available already in the biomass are 6.46 million tons. Next slide. The pyrolysis is of course known to all of us. We heat, in this particular case, biomass in the temperature range of about 350 to 550, where depending upon temperature, we get gases, liquid and solids. The fraction of gases increases as we increase the temperature, and the product contains hydrogen, carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, methane, ethane, and sometimes benzene, toluene, xylene as well. The liquid products, I'm going to show you the analysis little later, but can be used as transport fuel, as a feedstock for chemicals, and for making syngas. The solid that is char can give activated carbon or can be used as a support for catalyst, but the major requirement is the soil amendment, the use that I described about few minutes ago. Next slide. We have lot of laboratory experimentation. The kinetics of reaction is measured using thermogrammetric analyzer. We have drop tube apparatus, as well as there is a rotary kiln reactor where we can take about 1 kg to 20 kgs of material, but basic kinetics is obtained from TGA. We try to validate it by larger scale, whereas there is a continuous agar reactor for 5 to 10 kgs per hour for getting all these products. Next slide. Now I'm going to show you, since the title is Prosperity of Bottom Pyramid and how the prosperity can be obtained, I'm going to give you few examples out of those several possibilities, and one is making of biochar. Like my student has made cluster of 5 villages for sweet sorghum, like that this is a cluster of 5 villages and population. I know number of villages in India, and I know the population staying in the villages. This is possible in the internet. So what I have done is I have made so many clusters, and the land is also distributed, which is 5,000 hectares. And the biomass available in that particular land is 12,000 tons. which is already available. Now, what I'm saying, with the help of using biochar, I'm able to increase productivity by 50%. Not 300, not 200, not 85%, but just 50%. However, whatever is grown in India, only that much is required, generally. We don't need increase in productivity. So what is that farmers will do? Even they listen to us, then that is not required. The number of mouths are the same, and increase in productivity will remain with the farmers. So what we are proposing is, when increase in productivity is by 50%, then only 2/3 land can be used for meeting the current productivity. And remaining 1/3 land can be used for growing energy biomass, and that is bamboo. We have collaborated, up till now I told you, the collaboration with Agarkar Institute and Kokun Krishi Vidyapeth, and as the lecture continues, I will tell you the collaboration with at least another 10 to 15 organizations. So here for bamboo, there is Bamboo Research Institute, there are personal enthusiastic people, and then we took individually help of all of them and allocated separate land for all of them, and they claim that when the photosynthesis efficiency is 0.3%, then we get 10 tons of bamboo per year per hectare. If and they claim up to 4.5%, that is 150 tons per hectare per year. After consulting all these people and actual experimentation, we have been able to go up to 3% photosynthesis efficiency, that is 100 tons per hectare per year. What does it mean? When we make this cluster, out of 5,000 hectares, 1/3 land is now available because we have increased the productivity of remaining 2/3 and 1/3 is remaining. So increase in productivity is by 50%. Now the free land available for biomass is 1,600 hectares, and biomass produced from that is bamboo, is 160,000 tons. The bio oil is about 40%, and with 20 rupees a kg is 128 crores. The biochar, which we are going to use for improving fertility of land, 3 rupees a kg. So the typical expense that will occur is about 15,000 rupees per hectare. And I have already assigned 2.5 lakh rupees per hectare. The total income of all these products, the gaseous product I have not yet taken. Part of the gaseous product, since pyrolysis is an endothermic reaction, that gas, burning of gas, that particular heat of reaction is used for the pyrolysis. So total earnings are 142.4 crores. Next slide. See, before doing research, starting this research, I have three objectives in mind. The cash crop is 1,75,000. Can new activity can give 3 lakh rupees? That is, the entire project should be oriented to the benefit of farmers. That is point number one. Point number two is whether that activity is going to increase job opportunities. That is, the technology to be developed should be so simple that the fabrication can be made locally. That is, the local diploma holders or ITI holders, they can start workshops and make the equipment. And such plants will need people for operation. Lot of engineers will be required, managers will be required. So the increase in opportunity for the jobs, that is the second. The first one, and which is most important, the benefit must go to farmers. The second one, increase in number of jobs. And the third one, which is personally important because I'm a teacher, solve these problems through PhD students and develop confidence in them that they can solve the social problems. That is the third objective, and I'm very happy as a teacher that all our students, they have been able to take these challenges and solve these problems. So 3 rupees and 100 tons per hectare, this means 3 lakh rupees. So this is better than many cash crops. So in that particular cluster of 5 villages, now we need to pay 48 crores to the farmers. Number of pyrolyzers required are about 10, with a capacity of 50 tons per day. Capital cost is 15 crores. This is not imaginary, this is the actual number, because there is a plant which is operating at that capacity. Operating cost is 8 crores. We employ 500 people for fabrication, for maintenance, for production, for marketing, for supervising, for accounts, for the other management. But 500 people in the cluster and 12 crores of rupees. So the total expenditure is 98 crores. We have seen the gross income in the previous slide. Expenditure you see here. So 44.4 crores and payout period is 3.4. It's excellent business. In this biomass was bamboo. Another biomass which is abundantly available, about 15 to 16 million tons of coconut shells. When that is pyrolyzed, again basis is about the 50 tons per day. I need not go to the individual numbers now, but payout period is 430 days. And my another mentor, my first mentor is of course my guru, who is sitting here, and the second mentor, Mr. Kishore Bhai Mariwala, he has taken this challenge. He has a company that is Mariko, those who make parachute oil, and they have excellent management team who can make such clusters of either 5 villages, 6 villages. That exact module will come out after experience. But the pilot plant, as well as taking it further, that has already started. But see, the imagine 430 days. There can be mistake here and there, but 430 days, it cannot be for 4 years or 5 years or 10 years, or it cannot be 100 days. The order of magnitude is correct. And I have myself scaled up more than thousands of reactors in my life. So these are, you can take more or less, this is correct. Next slide. What is the result of this? The number of jobs, so I am writing this for one cluster. For one cluster, 500 jobs are created. Advantage to the farmers is 48 crores. Extra per capita income, and I had gone to the villages where per capita income was 40,000. If I distribute this 48 crores plus the profit to the local community, then increase in per capita income is 41,000. I am giving you just one example. In addition to things, the agricultural residue, many more things can be done in villages. Energy produced per cluster is 64,000 tons, which is 50,000 tons oil equivalent. The India has 200 million ton hectares. What I'm trying to say, how much possibility is there? The extra energy produced is 2,000 million tons of oil equivalent. And as compared to that, what is the existing energy consumption in India? 700 from in all the forms, electricity, household cooking, which consumes about 30% of energy, all everything put together is 700. So we wish by 2050 that our energy production should increase by a factor of 3. And I'm trying to show here is a potential candidate for making the energy. And number of jobs is 2 crores here. Just now we heard 10 crore people need the job. One example I have shown you, there is a possibility. And I'm going to show you second and third and fourth. I may explain to you about 5 examples. And now this is going to take care of carbon dioxide because of the increase in photosynthesis efficiency, about 6 gigatons. And because of our agreement in Paris, we are supposed to take care of 2.2 gigatons of carbon dioxide per year. So that particular our promise and problem can be sorted out with the help of enhanced efficiency. And then it will become CO2 neutral, because now the thermal power plant will have to use it on the basis of biomass. There will be challenges, of course, and there will be plenty challenges. The real challenges are related to social mindsets. That is, they should accept all these ideas. But how we are solving that, I will try to come to that little later. And jobs are 20 million. Next slide. So I have already told you the coconut shell. Next slide. We get phenol and perforal and diacetone alcohol, and we get char. And as compared to any other biomass, we get 22 rupees per kilogram. Next slide. In addition to various universities and organizations in India, MIT called us from Boston to collaborate with them. And what strength was seen from us? That we are able to do field experiments. That is, whatever char is produced, putting the char and do it scientifically, 36 at a time, and then measure the height and number of leaves and the overall biomass. There are many, many measurements which we are able to do. Now, this is a schematic diagram of MIT technology. Their objective is not to make gas liquid, but all solid char to be used for the soil amendment for increasing the productivity of land. So this is shredded biomass with the help of rotary valve. It comes down, and these are counter-rotating 2 screws. And about 5-6 months ago, I was in Boston, stayed with MIT for a number of days, discussed with them, tried to understand. Right now, they are facing a lot of difficulty in getting good quality at the outlet. And product is also non-uniform. In the morning, Professor Sharma, he emphasized the use of computational fluid dynamics. So this job has come to us, computational fluid dynamics, and we are confident that we will be able to do the CFD together with DEM and try to solve this problem. Here what is done, air is added at a location so that the endothermic heat, whatever is required, is fulfilled by burning some of the biomass. Now all the problem lies here only, that is, we are entering at one location, but when we want to go to multiple locations, which multiple locations and how much flow rate at which location? So CFD will definitely give an answer, and this collaboration is on. Next slide. So solar thermal technology, here we are collaborating with BRC. Next slide. This is the heliostat, and with the help of FEM, in solar thermal technology, 65% of the money is required for support structure to the mirrors. And by carrying out FEM analysis, we have been able to reduce the weight of support structure, and using nanotechnology, we have developed a new product as an absorber, having the efficiency of absorption of solar energy more than 90% and emittance less than 0.3. Now this is a very good development, and cost is also very, very favorable. So all that put together, next slide, the National Academy of Engineering of USA, they have put out several problems of importance to the world. And one of them is solar thermal. What is in the problem, the real problem statement is, can you make solar thermal technology and the entire technology to be expressed in the form of per meter square of reflection area? There will be turbine, there will be boiler, that is steam generator, there will be many more equipment. But all the capital cost you express per meter square of the reflecting surface. If you come to 75 and our students, they have been able to make this up to 75. Now what is hidden in 75? Right now, the current technology, the cost is $300 per meter square. And the electricity cost is about 5 cents per unit, approximately 5 cents per unit. And the government gives some subsidy by which we can sell the electricity at 15 cents. Right now, in a thermal power plant, the 9% IRR is considered a good value of IRR. Now, if it is $300 and we sell at the commercial price, then IRR goes down to 3.4%. So this is not acceptable. If we take the government subsidy, and this is never permanent, and we should never develop technology, but anyway, these are the numbers, then we can get IRR of about 11.2%, which is attractive. If the cost is reduced to 750, then the it is 5.9%, and with subsidy it is 15.6%. But when the cost is reduced to 15%, then inherently, with the same commercial cost of 5 cents per unit, the IRR is 11%. Now here the technology means there is a storage of molten salts. Either you keep the energy with molten salts whenever sun is not there by burning any biomass or fuel, and during daytime you provide energy to that molten mass by solar energy. And here solar fraction is assumed to be 50%, and all these calculations have been done. $75 per meter square and IRR usual 9% is considered attractive, and we can give to 11%. Next slide. This I have put just the paper based on this has been published in Nature Climate Change. We need to publish also, do useful work, but also publish. Otherwise, I won't be called for such a conference unless I become renowned in terms of publication. Next slide. The next subject is combustion. Pyrolysis is in absence of air. Combustion is in presence of air. So the combustion, we know, it happens in internal combustion engines. Next slide. And the Princeton University and some of the national laboratories in USA and the companies, General Motors, Ford and Chrysler, they came together and they identified problems. Flame quenching on engine surfaces, soot kinetics, complex composition of gasoline and diesel fuel, flow through intake and exhaust ports, influences of fuel variability and knocking. These were the problems. And all these problems were addressed by computational fluid dynamics. When we don't understand the fluid mechanics of multiphase flows, we go to empiricism. And empirical correlations, they are based on some experiments and those don't hold in reality. Next slide. So before starting this activity in Princeton, out of the 100% energy available, only 25% was available. That is, the internal combustion engine efficiency was 25%. 5% was lost in friction, 30% in coolant, and 40% in exhaust. By CFD simulation, they were able to find out at every location, every millimeter in the piston, what is the local efficiency. CFD of course included all the combustion reactions about 40-45, and eventually they could improve the combustion efficiency from 25% to 40%. I was able to see and discuss this personally when I visited USA in 2001, and it was really coincident that at that time our alumni, that get together was in Princeton, about 100-125 our past students, they were there, and I saw this. But there was one big banner on the, you know, the Princeton University in the department gate: in next 10 years we will improve the efficiency from 44% to 60% by further simulations, by further experimentation. This was really interesting, and I have been working in CFD now close to whatever, about 40 years at least. Next slide. So can I make the same problem statement for our household chulha? The number of families using biomass cook stove, these are 18 crores in India. Current thermal efficiency on an average is 12%. Whether I can do something, and Princeton got 44%, can I get 40%? And if I do that, then it can be 80,000 crores for the nation. And all those objectives are there. There's a benefit to common man. The title itself is prosperity of bottom pyramid. The second objective is, of course, whether there will be job opportunities. And third is, the problem is to be solved by students. In this activity, Professor Pandit, who is here today, he's of course part of the project. Next slide. This is the current scene with which we are familiar. If you go to villages, the most of the inefficiency goes via soot. And next slide. This is the cook stove that has been developed. The red line, red cylinder, is insulating ceramic cylinder, whereas this is conducting ceramic cylinder, whereas the blue one is the insulating ceramic cylinder. There is a fan and there is a fuel inside. Actual, this improved cook stove program in India, it started just after our independence, around 1950, and I started taking interviews with household women, and I was asking them, there are so many improved cook stoves, and you get a lot of attractions from the government, why are you not using it? And they told me so many problems associated with cook stoves. Now I think, according to me, for researchers this is important. That is, we should be solving what are the actual problems that people are facing, right? So I collected all those problems and did the CFD simulation of combustion in the cook stove. I'm going to show you only one slide, and there have been now second and third, three students who have been doing CFD simulation. Next slide. Now this was another innovation, and now we collaborated with IIT Mumbai, and Professor Bhargav from materials department, we collaborated with him, and the insulating cylinder and conducting cylinder, entirely both are ceramics and very low cost. The cylinder, both cylinders put together, we are able to make in less than 100 rupees. So this innovation has helped us. By the way, when I was talking to the household women, one interesting part was how much subsidy you want from the government. So without any element of doubt, none said that we want it free. None. Then how much price you are able to, what is your estimate? Anything between 750 to 1000 is okay. That is okay. So whenever we develop new technology, we always have one vendor along with us, and that particular vendor very, very actively participates in the research. Now this time there is a company called Sanjay Technoplast from Aurangabad, and when the research, of course, when we say that the 12% efficiency will go to 40% and 40 to 60%, but whenever we reach some number, then we take it the product out. Say if it is from 12% to 25%, then also out. So that 25% cook stoves, 6 lakh have been already sold. 6 lakh families have started using this. Next slide. These are CFD simulations, and these are temperature profiles and the support plate resistance, how does it vary, and the size of the biomass and the excess air. All those simulations have been performed. Next slide. Now you can see the cook stove, you see the flame. And this is the usual LPG. This is about 1200 degrees, this is 1080 degrees. And we are getting close to 50% efficiency. With 40% we were going to save nation about 80,000 crores, but it's already started giving about 50% efficiency. We are not put on the entry of our institution. In next 5 years, we'll increase this efficiency. Our vice chancellor is right now here. He may consider putting that banner, that in next 5 years, we'll increase it from 50% to 60%, and that will save 1,60,000 crores of rupees for our nation. Next slide. So we are talking about cook stove, and we are in the Himalayan, so livable Himalayan homes. So since the MIT saw potential in the ICT group, that we can solve the problems and simulate by computational fluid dynamics, then this was another problem, that is 40 million people live in Himalayan region, including parts of Bhutan, China, India, Nepal, and Pakistan. Many homes rely on biomass for heating and cooking. During cold seasons, indoor temperatures are often below 10 degrees. Maybe people here. So this is how the biomass is collected. Next slide. And the biomass, this is a cook stove. Next slide. I have not shown how the stove is kept in one corner in Himalayan home. The particulate matter, as per the world recommendation, it has to be less than 25 ppm. In Delhi, in November and December, it goes 10 times, 250, and becomes a big news throughout the nation, 250. But in Himalayan homes, this strong point of MIT is they have been able to develop very simple and economical gadget for measuring particulate matter, carbon monoxide, SOx and NOx. So this is NOx. So 300 is a big news, whereas here in Himalayan homes you get particulate matter 5000, 6000. Now this is to be solved. Next slide. I'm showing you one of the answers. One answer is, of course, improve the efficiency from 12-13% to 50%. So that will reduce the particulate matter by a factor of 4. But in Himalayan homes in the same community, you can see that the chatais are being made. And what was done by experiments, now these experiments are being done by MIT students, is a postdoctoral fellow. And now currently, one scientist of MIT is spending 100% time in Mumbai. So when these mats were put, the energy required for biomass reduced by a factor of 2. So the success has started. Now we are going to do simulations, CFD simulations. That is, whenever particulate matter is generated at the cook stove, how it distributes, and what should be the location of door and windows, and whether we should do modifications. And now we may collaborate now onwards with the architects also. Next slide. So this is the project. The simulations are there, laboratory experimentation is also there. And we will not construct a Himalayan home in Mumbai. We will come here in real Himalaya and try to do experiments there. Next slide. The cashew nut apples, I'll go very fast. The district which I visited, I told you, the Sindhudurg, and the southern part of Ratnagiri and western part of Kolhapur, geographically it is the same. We have divided into three districts. 22 lakh tons of cashew nut apples are thrown, 22 lakh tons. And the government had an initiative whether we can have a pilot scale project to convert this to ethanol for blending it with the petrol. But for making ethanol, the cost is 48 rupees, and 20 kgs of apples are required for making 1 liter of ethanol. I should give at least 2 rupees to cashew nut apples to the farmers. If I give 2 rupees, then the raw material cost is 40 rupees and selling price is 48 rupees. Then I have machinery, I have people, I have operating cost, I have energy. It is going to be never going to be economical. Therefore, we analyze these cashew nuts. Next slide. This is that apple. And here is the statistics of area versus productivity. Whenever we get, say, maximum cashew nuts of 2 tons, we get apples 20 tons. Next slide. So we developed this flow sheet, cashew nut apple screw press, 70% juice comes. From juice, flocculation, solvent extraction, we get tannin, we get phenols, polyphenols, and this acts as antioxidants. This is very useful in tanning industry. Supercritical fluid extraction, beta carotene, and dietary fibers. We know the price of selling. We have taken 75% of that. And all this is done now, already done. Next slide. Now if you assign all these, then this is 1448 rupees per 100 kilograms of cashew nut apples is the basis, and we get 1448. Now what remains is the bagasse, 30% bagasse, and now that is biotechnologically. Next slide. Now juice is already taken care of. If you make bioethanol, then which is 48 rupees per liter, we get additional money. If you make oxalic acid, that is not a good product, but oligosaccharides, that gives a lot of money. Next slide. Then there is a problem with jackfruits. Now this has been declared as the most healthy fruit of the world by UNO. Next slide. And now I will not read, but you can see, you can per kilogram of jackfruit, you can get 169 rupees. The subject of the lecture is prosperity of bottom pyramid. Once whatever is thrown, how much it is thrown? 15 million tons of these are, you can calculate, 169 rupees multiplied by 15 million tons. Next slide. The grape drying. Next slide. There is a consumption rate by 18% it is growing, and 17% it is growing, and right now the production and consumption is the same, but soon we will be fall short. Next slide. India consumes locally 62% and exports only 21%. You can see all other countries. Next slide. Whereas we are selling at 97 rupees a kilogram, and Afghanistan is selling at 225 kilogram. And the reasons are given here. I'll not read. Maybe I can circulate the slides. But there are the reasons. So whether we can address these reasons and solve this problem, and there is a export market. We are drying in the open, And therefore, particles are there, microorganisms are there. And whenever the moisture in the air because of the rains are increasing, driving force reduces, and whatever polyphenols are there inside grapes, they come out. If small quantity comes out, it becomes yellow, then brown, and some then we get black spots and we don't get any money. Next slide. Since it is advances, I am showing you 4 or 5 slides, which is really advances in chemical engineering. This is direct numerical simulation. These are the governing equations for mass, momentum and energy. These are solved completely. Next slide. This is a flow past a sphere and we get the flow pattern. Next slide. This is the drag coefficient which is calculated. Next slide. The drag coefficient, this is the experimental data which are already available, and the student who is doing this simulation, Shashank, is in the audience, and these simulations, and he has been able to predict this drag crisis also by DNS simulation, and this is the first time anywhere in the world where the drag crisis has been explained by analyzing the fluid mechanics. Next slide. These are Kelvin-Helmholtz stability. At any point, if you measure Stravall number, and then there is a large-scale vortex shedding, and these experimental data that is low frequency occurring behind immersed object, no physical explanation was given. And then the students, they have been able to provide the explanation, the secondary instabilities and what is the physics behind it. And therefore, this paper is published now already in physics of fluids. Next slide. So we did simulations for multiple particles, either in the fixed mode or expanded mode, and predict exactly the pressure drop given by Ergen equation, or whenever it is fluidized, the hindered settling velocity can be favorably compared with Richard Zaki equation. Next slide. And we have suspension viscosity. As the concentration of solids increase, you have. And there are many approaches which are simplified. Now this is done by computational fluid dynamics, that apparent viscosity can be predicted. Next slide. We can predict heat transfer coefficient and mass transfer coefficient also. See, there are several theories, film theory and Higbee's theory, and penetration theory and film penetration theory, and large theories are there. In reality, what happens whenever there is flow past sphere, all of these exist at the same time. There is some film at some location, some surface renewal is occurring, eddies of different sizes are coming, they are staying for different times. What is happening here, since the grid size is 10 raised to minus 5 and time is also 10 raised to minus 5, it has been able to resolve whatever is the reality, and we need not make any assumption. And we are able to predict the mass transfer coefficient, which I am using for a variety of purposes. Next slide. And one of the well-known correlation is Rands and Marshall, whereas DNS gives the right answer. Next slide. So using this understanding of heat and mass transfer, we have developed the technology from chromatographic separation. If we buy this from outside, we need to pay at least 10 times more. And plenty of these are now in successful commercial operation. We need about 800 to 1000 theoretical stages, and the particle sizes are between 15 and 40 microns. The pressure drop is about 10 atmosphere in 1 meter height. So the height cannot be big, but all these problems have been separated. The fractal-based distributor has been designed nicely and it is working. The gas phase fermentation, the requirement is that if you want to set up a plant of say 10,000 barrels, then the investment cannot be more than 200 million tons and operating cost less than 14 cents. If we wish to fulfill this criteria, then solubility of carbon monoxide or methane, whatever is to be fermented, that has to be, this is what Professor Sharma mentioned, but this we are getting in reality, and plant producing these 20,000 barrels per year is in actual operation, and we are getting on the plant scale 1 second inverse, that kind of dissolution. And now many more orders are coming. And now I have seen the opportunity of increasing the capacity by another 40% in the same plant. And then when I realize that there will be many more opportunities, and which will be solved by the student community. Design of safe atomic power plant as a replacement of retiring coal-based thermal power plants. It's a new activity which is happening in BRC, and technology for titanium. It is the Gharda group which is developing, and right now it is 200 kgs per day raw material. What is happening in India, the sand on the eastern coast has 50% titanium. We are selling it at 6 rupees a kilogram, and titanium price is, this I must have told you in my last lecture, and titanium price is 2500. And so many opportunities are there. I can tell you at least 10 more opportunities where value addition done by the outside world is 10 times, 20 times, sometimes 100 times, 6 rupees and 2500. So much value addition is there. Next slide. We have developed technology for carbon nanotubes. The worldwide price is, we have been able to make it in $10 a kilogram, whereas world price is more than $100. Dr. Meshelkar is helping me for commercialization. Technology is developed in collaboration with BRC. Those scientists are participating in a big way. Dr. Kakodkar is helping me for taking the technology out of the atomic energy, and soon you will see. Using the same carbon nanotubes, we have been able to make composite and made about 10 and given to 10 organizations for testing for bulletproof. And all of them have approved, and now Prime Minister has given order for 100,000, and Tata Group Company in Bangalore, that is Tata Advanced Materials Company, they are making 100,000 bulletproof jackets per year. I need to, This 26 January, since the production has started, we took 50 of them and given to CRPF to just to begin with. Next slide. So I'm not going to show you the details. Next slide. Just continue. I told you the summary. Here the carbon nanotubes are also useful. We use activated carbon as for the either platinum or rhodium as a support. When carbon nanotubes are used as a support, lot of modifications are required. We have been able to show that the activity can be enhanced at least by. So when we make in a fluidized bed in a supported carbon black, below 800 degrees, it is reaction control. Above 800 degrees, it is mass transfer control. Therefore, residence time required is 2 hours. And if you want to make such a huge quantity, then we need continuous process. So instead of carbon black, which is 50 microns, now the nano-sized particles have been used as a catalyst. So there is not internal resistance. We are using 1200 degrees centigrade. Continuous process has been developed where residence time is now 2 seconds. And the student who worked on this is now a faculty in ICT, that is Manish Yadav, and he is going to continue that work. He has been able to make CNT fiber also, having strength 3 times more than Kevlar. So he will scale it up, and that will be a good contribution. Next slide. Next slide. I think we should go to the end. Next slide. This is the continuous. There are challenges, many technologies. You can see lot of profit and prosperity can be increased. One example I have shown you that the per capita income can be increased by 40,000, and the same districts make also jackfruits, and there are many more opportunities. So here what we have done is the social mindset for understanding. We visited Tata Institute of Social Sciences, how to solve this problem. Then we came out with one idea, of course, that is to begin with a program called Masters in Social Entrepreneurship. And then first 6 months, they are taught about social mindset, the economics, the banking, the government rules, then the intellectual property rights, and all this is taught in the first semester. Then the next semester, they are free to go and try to identify the problems. Now we have a library of 300 problems by visiting all these people, all these districts. So they are free to find, and remaining 1 year is kept for solving that particular problem. Three batches have already come out. Plus, I'm using my contacts with the industry for getting those clusters and making cooperatives so that the prosperity of bottom pyramid really comes into practice. Thank you so much.